Welcome to Philadelphia Christian Church. Better is one day in the house of the Lord than thousands elsewhere. And these are your announcements. Join us Monday through Friday at 12:15 p.m. for noonday prayer and Tuesday at 7 p.m. for Bible study. This week is Family Week. There will be no school of prayer, so take this time to enjoy your first ministry.
If you're looking to be plugged into the church, you've been visiting for a while, and you feel that this is your church home, come and join us at the new members class. It will be Wednesday, January 25th at 7 p.m. We look forward to seeing you there.
Philadelphia, you've heard us talk about it. Now it's time to make it official. P.M.G. That's right. Philadelphia has now launched their new record label, Philadelphia Music Group, and we want to invite you to the official artist signing party on January 27th at the University of Louisiana Lafayette Student Union Ballroom starting at 7 o'clock p.m. Come celebrate the launch of your new label and the first artist to sign with PMG, January 27th, 7 o'clock p.m. at UL Ballroom. See you there.
All right, you guys, those were your announcements. Get up on your feet, it's worship time.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, give God some praise today. He's an awesome God, he's worthy this morning. Hallelujah. Glory, glory, glory. Come on, y'all, how many of y'all can find joy in Jesus? How many of y'all happy that y'all got joy today? It's a blessing to be in his house again. Hallelujah. Father God, we come before you today just acknowledging you, Lord God. Standing here with all creation as they bless you. The wind, the trees blowing in the wind, and as the birds sing in the morning, as the grass grows and testify the sovereignty of God. We stand here, all creation acknowledge you today, Lord God. And we come here acknowledging you, Lord God. Want to lift you up and magnify you in this place, Lord God. Asking that you would come before us, Lord God, and touch our hearts, Lord God. Open our hearts, Lord God. Prepare our hearts for your word. We come to bless you, Lord God, and give you what you deserve this morning, Lord God. And we say all these things in
Jesus' name.
Amen, amen. Hallelujah. Come on, y'all. Put your hands together.
Oh, come on. We're going to worship God this morning, y'all. We're going to sing unto God a happy song. Here we go.
So in love with you.
Sing it again.
Say,
serve you.
Yeah.
Believe him. How many of y'all believe him today? We come to tell y'all today that you're about to walk into a new season. There's a lot of generational curses about to be broken. And we've been tied up too long, but look, we're about to move forward in this year. Hallelujah. But you got to claim it. You got to speak it. Speak it in the atmosphere. Say, it's my season. It's my season. Hallelujah. Look at your neighbor. Say, it's my season.
Prosperity is a new season coming to me.
Come on, y'all, help me sing it. It's a new.
It's a new season.
It's a new day.
It's a new day.
Come on, a fresh anointing.
A fresh anointing.
Flowing my way.
The devil time is up, no longer can he bother me. The creator of the universe, he bothers me. And it's transferable, my children shall be free. Say, it's a new season.
It's a new season.
If you didn't know by now, you need to know his jubilee. My children, ha, they look, they set free. It's so available to you right now, just taste it. Come on, say, it's a new
season.
It's a new day, yes
it's
it
a
is.
New day.
Come on, a fresh anointing.
A fresh anointing.
It's going my way.
Going my way.
Season of power, say.
Season of power.
And prosperity. Come on, sing it out. Say, it's a new.
It's a new season.
Say, it's a new.
It's a new season.
Come on, one more time. It's a new
season.
A new millennium presents a new horizon. No greater time for us to make a choice and take a stand. All that you need is resting all in Jesus' hands. It's a new season.
It's a new season.
All that was stolen will return to you a hundredfold. Tried in the fire, but
coming out gold.
I know y'all like that. Come on. Look, say it's a new season.
It's a new
season.
Oh,
oh,
it's a new day.
A fresh anointing.
A fresh anointing.
It's flowing my way.
It's flowing my way.
Season of power.
Season of power.
And prosperity.
And prosperity.
It's a new season.
It's a new season.
Come on, it's coming.
Walk into the best year of my life. But you gotta claim it. You gotta claim it. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah.
This is my season for grace, for favor. This is my season to reap what I have sown.
Come on, y'all, let's all sing it.
This is my season
for grace,
for favor,
favor.
Oh, oh, yeah.
This is my season
to reap, to reap, to reap,
to reap what I have.
Come on, y'all. How many of y'all, this is y'all testimony right here. Hallelujah.
See, I haven't been perfect, but I sure been faithful. And God's got a purpose, and I know He's able. 'Cause I got a seed in the ground that He's blessing, no more stressing. I've got a seed in the ground, and it's growing.
Y'all see it? Y'all see it? Now it's showing.
This is my seed.
Come on, somebody just wave your hand in the air.
For favor,
favor.
This is my season.
Come on, y'all waiting for us to sing it.
To
He's waiting for you to sing it.
Oh, 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 oh.
My season
for grace,
for grace,
for favor,
for favor.
Yes, it is.
This is my season.
Come on, to reap, to reap
everything that you sow.
time, I want y'all to leave church singing this right here. Everything is working together for my good. Say,
everything is working.
Come on, together.
Together
for my good.
For my good.
Everything is working.
Everything is working
together.
Together
for my good.
For my good.
Together. Come on, for my good.
For my good.
I want y'all to speak it out in atmosphere. Somebody say, it's good.
It's good.
Say it's good.
It's good.
Say it's good.
It's
come
good.
On. I say it's working,
working
for my
good.
Say it's good.
It's good.
Say it's good.
It's good.
Say it's good.
It's hey. Good.
Because it's working for my good. It might not look good.
Good.
It might not sound good.
Feel good,
good, but it's
working, working for my good.
Say it's good.
It's good.
Say it's good.
It's good.
I say it's working for my good.
Say it's working for my good.
Hallelujah. 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 Come on, I want you to touch your neighbor right now. Just touch him on the shoulder. If you ain't scared, come on. I want you to say faith and favor on your life. Say faith and favor. Come on, God is about to take you into another level, but he wants you to believe. Come on, because look, say he's leaning hey, in my direction. Come on, let's lean to the right. Let's say it. Come on, here we go. Say he's leaning. Come on, that's God prophesying with your body.
In my direction.
Hey, say he's
leaning
in my direction. In my
direction.
Come on, we're gonna sing it again.
This is my season
for grace,
for grace,
for favor,
favor.
Oh yeah,
this is my season.
Come on, to reap,
to reap what I.
Come on, put your hands in the air right now. Put your hands. Say I've got a seed in the ground. Come on, he see. Say, I've got a seed in the ground.
I've got a seed in the ground.
Everything is working.
Everything is working.
Come on.
Together.
It's working together.
For my good.
Everything is working now.
Everything is working.
Come on, you gotta sing it like you mean
together.
It. Together.
For my good.
God is shifting some things. Come on.
Everything is working.
Together.
Together.
You might not understand it, but.
For my good.
Everything is working now.
Everything is working.
Together.
Together.
For my good.
For my good.
Come on, we're going to sing this part right here. Somebody say, it's good.
It's good.
It's good.
It's good.
Say, it's good.
It's good.
Because it's working
for my
good. Say, it's good.
It's good.
Say, it's good.
It's good.
Say it's good.
It's good.
And yes, it's working
for my good.
It might not feel good.
It's good.
It might not sound good.
It's good.
It might not taste good.
It's good.
But it's working
for my good.
Say it's good.
It's good.
Say it's good.
It's good.
I say it's working for my good. Say
working for my good.
Hallelujah. Come on, somebody lean on your neighbor. Somebody lean on your neighbor. Say, I'm not mad. Look, this God. Come on, just lean on him. Say, I don't know about you. You can act stuck up, but I know what God has for me. Just lean on him. Say, don't get mad at me. It's God. Hallelujah. Glory.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. What if I told you that all the seeds you planted was coming into fruition and that this was your season? How would you praise him if this was your season? How would you praise him? How would you praise him? Come on, TJ. How would you praise him? How would you praise him? How would you praise him? Huh? How would you praise him? How would you praise him? How would you praise him? Come on now. Come on now. Come on now. Come on now. Hey! How would you praise him? How would you praise him? How would you praise him? If every seed, every offering, every prayer, every day fasting was coming into manifestation on this time, this season, how would you praise him? Hallelujah! Hallelujah! How would you praise him, Miss T? Hallelujah! If it was really your season. Well, I got some news for you this morning. Some things are coming to pass in 2017. Hey! I done got an email from the Most High. Some things are coming to pass in 2017. Hallelujah. Things you've been waiting for, praying for, fasting for, tithing for, offering for. You've been waiting on it and God been waiting to bless you. Hey! But I think right now you're ready. I think 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 you are 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 ready. I know that you're ready. I know that you're ready. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. See, before if he would have gave it to you, you would have hurt yourself. But you're not going to hurt yourself no more. You know what God expects from you. You know a little bit of blessing ain't going to change your heart. Hey, look at your neighbor and say, I'm not going to hurt myself. Look at your other neighbor, I'm not going to hurt myself. I can handle a blessing. Come on, give God some glory, amen. I can handle it. I can handle it. Hallelujah. Thank you, Daddy. Father, we praise you, God, and lift up your most holy name. We thank you that seasons change, Lord God. That it don't stay winter forever. It don't stay fall forever. Things don't die forever. But there's a time for everything under the sun. Woo! And we thank you that in that time, there's a time to sow. Hallelujah. And there's a time to reap. I thank you, Daddy, is reaping time. I thank you, is reaping time. I like that. I like that. I like that. Come on. Show Daddy is reaping time. Show Daddy is reaping time. Show Daddy is reaping time. Come on, receive it. 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 In the mighty name of Jesus. We thank you, it's reaping time. And I pray, God, right now, standing in agreement for what you're revealing to us in the spirit. That every business idea, every single, Lord God, ounce of work that's sown on the job, every tithe, every offering, every penny given to your name, every single prayer, God, every day fasting, God. God, I'm praying that you give to your people a hundredfold everything that they've sown. God, in the name of Jesus. I can see it, Daddy. I can see the seeds germinating. They opening up. I can see them popping up the soil, God. And I can see them growing up into stalks, Lord God. I can see them budding, Lord. I can see harvest time. The Bible tells us, hallelujah, though we sow in tears, woo, we shall reap in joy, the Bible says. That's what the Bible says. So God, in the name of Jesus, make us reapers right now. We pray, God, that we will enter a season to where we so blessed, Lord God. We got accounts everywhere, Lord God. We got investment properties everywhere, Lord God. We got houses and lands, Lord God. We thank you, Father God, for hallelujah, God. You providing everything that we need, Lord God. That we won't struggle for bills no more. That the light bill will be nothing and the phone bill will be nothing, God. That could just come off the extra, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God. And Father, we pray in the mighty name of Jesus that with all that you give us, we would never take our eyes off you, God. That we would continue to seek first the kingdom of heaven and your righteousness, and that all these things would be added unto us, that we would put you first in everything, Lord God. So, Lord, bless us indeed. Now, Father, be with us as we have this service, God. Let your spirit fill this place and fill every vessel here. Save the lost, sanctify the saint, edify us, build us up, strengthen our unbelief, because there's some that don't believe in here, that is their season, Lord God. But I'm going to have faith for them, Lord God. I'm going to believe for them, Lord God. I'm going to be like the friends of the paralytic who brought the man with their faith to get his miracle. I'm going to believe the miracle for you. God, in the name of Jesus, bless your people, God. Bless your people. And bind that old devil out this place in every manifestation. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen, amen. Come on, come on, give God some glory. 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 Hallelujah. Now the Bible says that God's people would be like their God. They would be able to speak those things that are not as though they were. Amen. And I need y'all to speak over one another right now. I need you to find three people, and I need you to speak over them. It is your season. Come on, just find three people. I got one right here. It is your season. Woo! It is your season. Woo! It's reaping time. It's harvest time. It's harvest time. It is your season. It's harvest time. It's harvest time. It's harvest time. Every prayer. Every prayer. Children getting saved. It's your season. All them prayers for the children, they going to be saved. It's your season. All them prayers for them spouses, they will be saved. It's your season. It is your season. Hallelujah. It is your season. Thank you, Daddy. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. It is your season. Hallelujah. Every prayer. Every prayer. Every prayer. Every prayer. It is your season. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord God. Now, saints of God, I'm going to be honest with you. Amen. Thank you, Miss Aola. Hallelujah. I received that. I received that. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. I want to tell you, the thing about seasons is that, listen, hallelujah, when you sow in one season, you reap in the next season. Anybody hear me, all right? So what you are about to receive is what you sowed in a previous season, all right? Now, the smart farmer, amen, not only sows when he's receiving. He not only sows when he don't have nothing, but he sows when he's receiving, all right? And what happens is, amen, when you reaping and still sowing, all right, the next season, you're going to continue to reap. Maybe you continue to sow. And the next season, you're going to continue to reap and continue to sow. The smart farmer plant not only to receive a spring harvest, but a winter harvest and a fall harvest. And every year, every season of the year, hallelujah, that farmer is receiving something from the earth. Anybody get what I'm talking about, all right? So what I'm saying is you got to take some of your harvest now and sow it in the now so that you can receive it in the later. Anybody hear me right now? All right? All right? All right? Hallelujah. And so here we are, Philadelphia. It's sowing time right now. All right? So plant a seed. Amen? Sow. Amen? Go ahead and give to God. And when I say give, amen, number one, we start off with the tithe, and that's the base minimum. Amen? That's the base minimum. All right? But every now and then you want to put a little something on top for the Lord, an offering unto the Lord. Amen? Hallelujah. Because the tithe is going to get you an overflow. Woo! But the offering going to put a little something more special on that. Lanyap. Amen? So Philadelphia, needless to say, it is offering time. Come on, give God some glory. Amen? Hallelujah. Ushers, if y'all can come on up. Amen? We're going to receive the Lord's seed. Amen. Hallelujah. And you know where this is going. Amen. To build this ministry that's saving souls. To educate our children in our schools. Amen. For us to be on UL campus with PCM. Amen. it's going to a great cause so that the radio, hallelujah, can get the word out, amen, so we can continue to have campaigns and give away free cars like we do to the people of God, amen. And so your money's going in a good place, amen. You're not like them little churches where they tithe and they still in a little church, amen. It's not like that. It's not like that. Amen. Amen. It's not like that. Hallelujah. You see where the money going. You see where it's going. Hallelujah. And so here we go. Hallelujah. Here we go. When the music starts, y'all come up and give unto the Lord so that the Lord can know that you're not just a receiver, but that you a giver. Come on and give it in Jesus' mighty name. Hallelujah. Hundredfold blessing on you. Hundredfold blessing on you. Hundredfold blessing on you, Miss Lou. Hundredfold blessing on you, Miss Mary. Hundredfold blessing on you, Parker Man. Hundredfold blessing on you, my brother. Hundredfold blessing on you, Dad. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Bam. Hallelujah. Hundredfold blessing on you, Benoit. Hundredfold blessing on you, Rito, Kimmy. Hundredfold blessing on you, B. Hallelujah. Hundredfold blessing on y'all. Hallelujah, Miss Erlene. Hundredfold blessing. Hundredfold blessing. Hundredfold blessings, Flujas. Hundredfold blessing. Hundredfold blessing. Hundredfold blessing, Brother James. Hundredfold blessing. Grace abound to you. Grace abound to you, Mr. Lucius. Grace abound to you, Mr. Robinson. Grace abound to you, Brother Rob. Hundredfold blessing. Hundredfold blessings. Hallelujah. Raises, promotions, deals. Amen. Hundredfold blessing on y'all. Hundredfold blessing on your first cousin, Scotty Como. Hundredfold blessing on you. In the mighty name of Jesus. Hundredfold blessing on every single one of y'all. Every single one of y'all. Hundredfold blessing on you, Miss Chantel Marie Daniel Tebow. Hundredfold blessing on you. Hundredfold blessing on you. In the mighty name of Jesus. Hundredfold blessing on you, young lady. Hundredfold blessing. In the mighty name of Jesus. Hundredfold blessing on you, Brother Joseph. In the mighty name of Jesus. Hundredfold blessing. Hundredfold blessing. Hundredfold blessing, young lady. Hundredfold blessing. Hundredfold blessing on you, young lady. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord God. Brandon, hundredfold blessing on you. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Come on, give God some glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you it's a new season, God. We thank you it's a new season. We feel the new season. We feel it. We discern it, Father God. So, God, in the mighty name of Jesus, God, we pray everybody who's put some seed in the ground, Lord God, that you would plant it and allow it to be planted with miracle grow, Lord God. Put that blue water on it, God. Put that Holy Ghost on it, God. Put the good stuff on it, God. For we know that one plant, one water, but the Lord calls it to increase. So increase it now, Lord God. Bless your people, God, with what their heart desire. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen, amen, amen. Come on, give God some glory. Hallelujah. Ushers, y'all can follow Minister Anon, hallelujah, and Minister Duck. They're going to take care of y'all, hallelujah. And we're going to get cranked up with a few things that we have to do, hallelujah. How y'all doing this morning? Y'all all right? Hallelujah. I got some good news for y'all. It's one more week till the fast is over, saints, amen. Isn't that good news? All right. And so, like I say, man, you know, it's really quick. It don't feel quick when people eating around you, but it's really quick, amen? And so next Sunday when we come, the fast is going to be over. It's going to be done with, amen? And I'm going to tell you, when you get used to fasting and get used to the spiritual revelation and the closeness, you know what I'm saying, the connexity, the proximity of God, the end of the fast is going to be kind of bittersweet. Because you're gonna feel like you want to continue to hear him. And when you see the blessings coming during the fast. Anybody receiving blessings of revelation and opportunities? Amen. I know we are. Just things just moving that never moved before. Hallelujah, man. And so you get used to that, amen. But it's just a testimony that we should continue to fast periodically throughout the year. Amen. And just remember, hallelujah, officially Saturday is over. You can do until Sunday if you want, amen. You can fast all year if you want, amen. It's all about what you want to do in your relationship with the Most High God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. All right, let me see what we have today by way of announcements, and then we're going to get cranked up with the Hebrew nugget. By way of announcements, amen. The church anniversary is coming up, hallelujah, in April, hallelujah. And so the women of God are putting together something big, amen. We have a limited amount of tables, amen. So if you want to get your table, go ahead and get your table, hallelujah. And the way it works is, amen, individuals or ministries or families putting together and getting tables, amen. And you decorate your table and you provide different things for your table. It's an awesome way, amen, for everybody to show their creativity, amen, whether it's in cooking or decoration, amen, and for us to celebrate our anniversary, amen, and not be too much of a burden to the ministry. And so it's a great way for us to get all of those things accomplished. And so if you want to get a table, see my wife, amen, Miss Chantel, hallelujah, or send her a text through Sisters United, hallelujah, and you want to get your table quickly. Amen. Next announcement is I don't know if anybody, if y'all know, we actually launched, amen, a record label. Hallelujah. Come on, give God some glory. Amen. Hallelujah. It's called Philadelphia Music Group, PMG. Amen. And we got different people in the ministry that's helping out with it. Amen. Minister Phil. Amen. Vice President of Promotions and stuff like that. We have Minister Duck, hallelujah, Vice President, Manager, amen. They know the music, amen. And so it's just an awesome, awesome opportunity that's opening up. And we have our artists, amen, the people that God has blessed us in our ministry, amen. We got Jay Malvo right here, amen. And a slew of other ones, amen. And so we're going to go ahead and launch this. We actually have a signing party, amen, on January 27th, amen. January 27th, so mark your calendars. We would like, you know, y'all to come. Space will be limited, so you won't come early, you know what I'm saying? And I don't know what time it starts, but come early. Okay. Seven. All right, so 7. We're going to have it at the UL Ballroom. You know that ballroom they just built at UL? We're going to have it over there. Hallelujah. We're going to have some free, like, refreshments and hors d'oeuvres and stuff like that. And so you can come for that. Hallelujah. And we're going to sign a bunch of artists in Philly, the talented ones. And we got some that we may not sign that night, but they're going to sign. Amen. And so don't worry about that. And all I ask is that you don't just start beatboxing in front of Minister Duck and singing in front of Minister Phil. Amen. Let your gift make room for you. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. That was just a funny, y'all. Y'all supposed to laugh at that. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. All right. So the signing party, January 27th. Amen. If you need a tithe statement, all right, if you need a tithe statement, some people need a tithe statement because they at a place where they actually pay taxes back. If you need a tithe statement, meaning that you're in a place where you're paying taxes back, amen, you can go in the foyer. We have a table set up, amen, and you can put your name and your current address, hallelujah, and they'll get it ready to give to you. What we've been doing in the church, we've been sending out all the tithe statements, and some of y'all really don't need it, you know what I'm saying? And some of y'all really like, y'all like, I don't need it. And we've been getting old addresses, spending money on stamps. And so if you need it, if you want it and you need it, just go to the table, fill out the little paperwork, and we'll get it to you. Amen. And if at any time you thought you didn't need it and you need it now, we'll print it out for you on the spot. You know what I'm saying? So it ain't no big deal. We're not trying to, like, keep nothing from you. We're just trying to save the church. We're just trying to manage effectively what the Lord has given us. Amen. All right. Next thing is this. It's family week this week. And so we shouldn't have too many meetings. I noticed on the calendar that we do have some 12 meetings this week. So some things got kind of off as far as our scheduling. I'm going to allow those 12 meetings to go on. But if you try that next one, it's going to be on. Amen. All right. So family week. Amen. We want to just tone it down as far as the amount of meetings we have. And I saw who having the 12 meetings. But maybe I'm not going to say it's your fault. Maybe we just kind of got a little bit twisted. Hallelujah. On the scheduling and stuff like that. Remember what family week is about. Is about keeping the church strong. How? By keeping the family strong. Amen. Some of y'all don't care about y'all families, but other people do. Amen. Some people don't want to be with their wife, but some people do. Amen. All right. So we want to be cognizant of that. Amen. Yeah, I'm a little bit sharp when I'm fasting. Don't worry about that. I'm hungry, so I will be. Don't mean I don't love you, all right? But I'll bite your arm off right now. All right. So, okay, all right, let's see what else. Talking about food, the Grow Your Own Food Challenge. Amen. Hallelujah. Sabrina, y'all got a big new backyard back there. Hallelujah. I could plant my garden in y'all yard too. Hallelujah. So Grow Your Own Food Challenge. Heavy, y'all got a lot of space back there, baby. You're going to have to come with it, though, Heavy. All right. So everybody try to get your little garden. Amen. Big brother, you got a nice backyard too. Amen. Hallelujah. Put your little garden back there. You got two yards. You can plant at this house or the other house. So hallelujah. Just plant your own food. Amen. And we're going to take pictures of it. And we're going to get some judges. And we're going to give an award for that. Come on, give God some glory. Amen. All right. We got a lot to do this morning, saints, but I wanted to get through all those announcements. Amen. Let's go ahead with the Hebrew nugget. Amen. And on the Hebrew nugget, I'm going to take a little bit more time this morning because it's something so prevalent to the current day that we live in. And so I'm about to try to reveal some mysteries hidden. Amen. Hallelujah. For a long time. We're going to reveal what the devil's doing. If anybody new to Philadelphia and you don't know what the Hebrew nugget is all about, amen, we are a church, a Philadelphia Christian church, who believes that the current people who claim to be Jews, amen, are not Jews at all, amen. And we're doing that consistently with the scriptures in Revelation chapter 3 and Revelation chapter 2, amen. If the sound booth can get maybe that one of those scriptures up, amen. And the Bible says, prophet, that there is a people who claim that they're Jews, but they are not, amen. And the whole world is deceived right now. And you got a people living in Israel who are not the real people. They are actually imposters. Amen. And we not only say, number one, our first premise is that they're imposters acting like they're the true biblical people of God. But it's true. That's why they don't call themselves Israelites. They call themselves something else because they are not the Israelites of the Old Testament. But the second premise is, hallelujah, you should ask the question, well, if they're not the real people, then who are the people? All right? And my second premise, amen, hallelujah, founded upon biblical, archaeological, geographical, amen, evidence, literary evidence, amen, that the current so-called African Americans, amen, and a slew of different people around the world, the Latinos and the people in the Caribbean islands, amen, who were caught up in the slave trade, who formerly lived in a place called Negro Land, amen. They weren't Africans, they were Negroes, amen. These are the real, true Hebrew Israelites. And I showed you in the scriptures in Jeremiah and the Song of Solomon, where they describe the pigmentation of their skin. I'm dark and lovely, amen. Hallelujah. When I was going through, my skin was black. Anybody hear me up in here? All right. Jesus in the scriptures through John the apostle, the revelator, said that his feet was like bronze and his hair was like wool. We've been sitting on this for all these years. Woo! But now finally it's coming to light. Come on, give God some glory. Amen. You want to know who the people are? We the people. Woo! We are the people of the living God. We the one that y'all been dreading on. Now we sleeping giants. All right, I'm rapping. All right, look at that. I love that. That is awesome. All right. So for the Hebrew nugget for today, I'm going to take a little time because remember, I didn't even finish the lesson from last Sunday. So we just going to finish it off. So I just might need 30 or 40 minutes to finish it off. But I want to take a little more time and deal with this. And God knew it. In fact, he spoke to me and my wife to cover this, all right? It's a dangerous subject, so security, be watchful. Hallelujah. But brothers, y'all can sit down and be watchful. Mark, y'all have a seat, Mark. Y'all have a seat. Hallelujah. I'm going to talk with you this morning about something that's called the Federal Reserve. The Federal Reserve. TP done shook his head. Oh, God. My brother-in-law gonna get knocked off. No, he won't. If God be for me, who gonna be against me? Huh? Come on. Hallelujah. We're talking about the Federal Reserve. Amen. The current slave system in America. All right? They didn't exchange the thing about just having black slaves. Now they got white and black slaves. Everybody a slave. Hallelujah. Now, to talk about the Federal Reserve System, I have to do something really, really deep right here. Remember, we talked about the Ashkenazis, and I showed you the Talmud, the protocols, and what they're doing in the earth. But I have yet to reveal to you who is actually the head of the Ashkenazi Empire. Anybody hear me up in here? There is a head. There is a head. There is a group. There is a family who actually runs the Ashkenazi mechanism and machinery. There's some of you who know the name. They don't even say the name in public. The richest family, but they'll never put them in Forbes magazine. Anybody could say the name, whisper it, not whisper it. Rothschild. To understand the Federal Reserve, you got to understand that family that runs the Ashkenazi machinery, been running it. And we're talking about the Rothschilds, the Ashkenazis, imposters, false Hebrews, false Jews, and they're actually Luciferians who worship Satan. Listen to me. The Rothschild story and the Federal Reserve story starts off with one man, Mayor Amschel Bayer. You see? He was born in Frankfurt, Germany in 1743. Y'all just flip pictures with me. Hallelujah. When I raise my hand, just flip. All right? Hallelujah. Just stay right there. Hallelujah. This man's father was a moneylender. He was a banker and a goldsmith. He opened a counting house, kind of like a bank, and Bayer put a red shield on the door. A lot of people say that that red shield is the current flag of Israel today. We put that Star of David. That ain't a Star of David. That's a Star of Rothschild. We put that on everything. Even Christians put that on prayer cloths and all kind of stuff. That's foolery. That's not the Star of David. The Bible don't even talk about a Star of David. The Bible talk about a key of David, but it don't talk about a Star of David. You see? That's not in the Bible. In fact, some say that that star, so-called of David, is actually the mark of the beast. And, oh, y'all don't want to hear that. Y'all don't want to hear that. You don't want to hear that. You don't want to hear that. All right? You don't want to hear the truth. But he put that shield on his door. You see? Mayor took over the family business. Started lending, not just to regular folk, but he said he could make more money. Come on, my wife, correct me if I'm wrong. He could make more money lending to nations, to nobles, and to princes. And so he just went from, listen, we're not talking about just, you know what I'm saying, home bank or nothing like that. He went from lending to regular folk to nations, to princes, to kings, to queens. He said, because I know they're going to pay. And when they can't pay, they can just tax their own people and get my money. No, you gotta feel me now. We talking about the Federal Reserve. Did you know there was no IRS before there was a Federal Reserve? Did you know you only pay taxes because there is a Federal Reserve that lend money to America? Amen. And America got to pay that money. And the way America pay that money is to tax the regular folk. Oh, you don't want to know the truth. You don't want to know the truth. You want to stay shallow. You want to stay shallow. You want to just talk about Bible without putting it into the practical living age that we live in? You just want to talk about abstract theologies? Or you want to make the Bible fit where we are today? Huh? You want to see what Revelation really talking about? The second beast? The number that will control the financial institutions of the world where you cannot buy or sell without having that mark on you. You won't talk about the Bible in current day? Well, let me reveal something to you. All right? So Rothschild, Mayor Bauer, changed his name to Mayor Rothschild. And all Rothschild mean is red shield. Amen. He had about five sons. I think it's about five. Y'all can check it. Correct me if it's not five, it might be six, but I think he had about five sons. And with his five sons, hallelujah, he put a bank in almost every major nation. Amen? Every major nation. And what he did on first, it was every major nation in Europe. He put a bank in Berlin, that's Germany. Vienna, that's Austria. He put a bank in Paris, that's France. He put a bank in Naples, that's Italy. And he put a bank in London, all right? Now you got to understand finances back then. G-Money, the way finances used to work is when you lived in a different nation, all right, you did business in gold, all right? And so if I was in another nation, I wanted to buy something in Paris, but I'm from Italy, amen, I got to have my gold shipped, all right? And if I was making a big purchase, that gold was heavy, and people could steal that gold while it was on the way. So what the Rothschild said is, we got a bank in Italy. You just deposit with us, all right? And you can go ahead and pick the money up, woo, almost Western Union. You could pick the money up, hallelujah, over here in Germany, wherever you need it. And so they replaced the financial system with a credit system. Oh, God, help me, somebody. Meaning that you can come pick up some money, but you got to pay us the money sometime later. Over here, they replaced the old system with a system of credit and debits. All right? They began to control the money of nations, meaning that nations would borrow so much from them that they would own the nations. One nation in particular they owned was London. England, Great Britain, who was the powerhouse of that time. All right? In 1790, Mayor Rothschild says this. This is a statement from himself. He says, "Let me issue and control a nation's money, and I care not who writes the laws." If I got the money, I don't care who making the laws, because the money control it. The money control it. They're going to come check with me before they write a law. You see? When you control a nation's money, we got a picture. Come on. We got a picture. When you control a nation's money, who controls the issuance of money controls the government. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's not too deep for y'all, huh? All right? So he had control of all of Europe, Philadelphia. And all of a sudden, a new nation was born. A new nation was born across the Atlantic that they had no control of it. Of. A nation of democracy. A nation of freedom. A nation built on not the rich, not the nobles. A nation built upon a premise, we the people of the United States. Anybody hear me up in here? That all men were created equal. That God gave unto all men certain inalienable life rights, which was life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Nobody would control nobody. We would live and we would be free and we would pursue our happiness and everything would be under God and we would serve God and it sound good on paper. Anybody hear me up in here? But the Rothschild say we can't never let this happen. Just like we control Europe, we got to get control of this new nation. Oh, I'm giving somebody a history lesson up in here. Anybody want to learn the truth up in here? I gave you a scripture, the people who claim they're Jews but are not. That's who we're talking about. All right? God wanted me to talk about that Federal Reserve. Look, the Times, London, controlled by the Rothschilds, amen. And then the Ashkenazis, remember, they control newspapers and stuff like that. They say, hallelujah, quote, it says, hallelujah. No, y'all can go back. You know what? Just stay right there. It says this. It says, if that mischievous financial policy, which has its origins in North America, this constitutionally authorized no debt money, should become indurated down to a fixture, then the government will furnish its own money without cost. It will pay off debts and be without debt to the international bankers. This new country, America, if it don't owe the bankers no money, it will become prosperous beyond the precedent in the history of civilized governments. The brains, the wealth of all countries will go to America. That government, America, the Rothschilds say, must be destroyed, or it will destroy every monarchy on the globe. See, the Rothschilds read the Constitution. And our Constitution says that America must print its own money. That nobody should print money for us. We should print our own money, all right? At the time, Brandy, the Rothschilds not only had nations under debt control, but they would print the money. You had to go to them to get money, a banknote, all right? Let's keep going. I'm not going to stop. From the beginning of America, they fought to control our money, Ms. Chantel. And in history, they succeeded at one point. They had the first Bank of the United States. But our founding fathers had wisdom. They put an expiration date on the charter. The bank could only operate for so long, and then the charter was expired, and they had to go back to Congress to renew that charter. Hallelujah. The founding fathers knew what they were doing in Europe, and so they didn't easily renew the charter. So they got a first bank. They got a second bank. And when they went to get a third bank, America said no. In 1811, America told the Rothschilds, the international bankers, no, you're not going to print our money, and for that matter, we're not going to borrow no more money from you. You might have London, you might have London, you might have Germany, you might have those other countries, but you're not going to own America. They did that in 1811. 1812, the very next year, the Rothschilds sent Great Britain to attack America. Is known as the War of 1812. Now follow me now. And the reason London, England attacked America was because we were not doing business with the Rothschilds. If you don't do business with the central banks, the Federal Reserve, the IMF, if you don't do business with them, they will go to war with you. It's going to be very important for you to understand this truism, for when we come down later into our modern times, and you will see that every war that's been happening in the past few years has been about the same thing. People not wanting to do business with the Rothschilds. It's been about money. Ooh! I'm about to show you something. Stay with me. You see what I'm saying? So Andrew Jackson, general, he fought in the War of 1812. Here's our other little picture of Andrew Jackson in the Battle of New Orleans, amen. He fought in the War of 1812. He knew what it was all about, and he knew about the international bankers. And so Andrew Jackson said, hallelujah, I'm not going to let y'all get this new bank where y'all issue money to America. It's not going to happen. In fact, when he become president, look what he says. He tells the international bankers, you are a den of thieves, vipers, and I intend to rout you out. And by the eternal God, I will rout you out. That's what he said to the bankers, y'all. And if y'all don't know, amen, guess what somebody with a whole bunch of money and a whole bunch of people working for them and no morals and actually worship Satan, what would they do to one man that was trying to stop them from controlling America? Knock him off. And so they attempted to assassinate Andrew Jackson. Amen. And here's a depiction of the assassination and the assassin. They tried to shoot him, but God was protecting Andrew Jackson. Because he didn't want America to be under Rothschild control, because they're not the people of God. It's the synagogue of Satan. And so when he went to try to shoot Andrew Jackson, one gun jammed. He dropped that gun and picked up another gun. And that gun jammed as well. And Andrew Jackson, the old general, hallelujah, went ahead and proceeded to put his cane upside that boy's head. All right? All right? All right? And for the duration of his presidency, he kept the banks from controlling America, the international banks. I'm not talking about your local banks. And don't go take your money out of that. In fact, I just opened some accounts this week. Amen? You can go to your bank of your choice. Mid-South is a great bank. You can go to home. I'm talking about on a large scale. All right? And we can get to it if we trickle it down. Anyway. So, all right. Andrew Jackson, they say, what is your greatest accomplishment? He was about to die. What is your greatest accomplishment? If there was one thing you could put on your tombstone, what would you say, Andrew Jackson? He says, I killed the bank. Anybody hear me up in here? All right. What I'm telling you is not fantasy. It's accurate history is what I'm telling you. And you can go and research this. If you don't know where you've been, you'll never know where you're going. If you don't know your history, you won't know what's going on today. All right? There were people in our history fighting against something that we can't even see today. He said, I killed the bank, you see. But the thing about the Rothschilds is that when people die, their family continues. And they continue with a demonic tenacity. Plans, it's demonic. How can one generation pick up in the wickedness of the previous generation with no let off? So Andrew Jackson dies, but the Rothschild mandate continues. You see? And so here we have a man by the name of Abraham Lincoln comes on the scene. And Abraham Lincoln, amen, he wants to free the slaves. He's an abolitionist by heart, amen. He feels that the American Constitution has only delivered a half promise, amen, by deeming that all men are created equal. He's a godly man, amen. And I believe in my heart, amen, he was for blacks. He was for the Hebrews. And he was almost like a Moses in that day. He wanted to set the people free. And when I read his writings, that's what I get. A lot of people say it's about something else, but no, it wasn't about nothing else. He wanted the slaves free. You see what I'm saying? He personally saw a lynching, and it affected him, hallelujah, for the duration of his life. You see? But when he tried to set the slaves free, he had resistance. All right? And the resistance wasn't about states' rights. That was just a cover. The resistance wasn't even about prejudice. Even though that played an important part, that was just a cover too. Do you want to know what all major wars are fought over? Say it again, big brother. Money. All right? The people on the plantations was making a lot of money. Now, what you don't know and people are scared to talk about, but people like Farrakhan who don't care about what people say, he'll tell you who owned the slave ships and who owned the majority of the plantations. It was the Ashkenazi false Jews. Listen to me. When you walk around here, white folk act like they were the plantation owners. White folk act like they had you in slavery. White folk wasn't the plantation owners, Cole. There was only a small minority of them that was. Most of the slave ships belonged to big money. Belonged to the Ashkenaz. Nobody want to say this. In fact, they contacted Farrakhan when he gave that information. They said, you better stop talking about that. Farrakhan said, I ain't stop talking about nothing. Because it's the truth. The Ashkenaz is on the slave ships, Dawana, and they own the plantations. You go back to them names, and you'll see it. You go back and research history, you'll see it. But when Lincoln came down, and Lincoln said, we're going to abolish slavery. And the boss said, man, what are we going to do with our free labor? And our transatlantic slave trade. Well, we're going to concoct an idea. We're going to start a wall. They're so good at putting out propaganda to skew the public. They began to tell the whites in the South, the North is trying to run the South. And y'all states have rights. The North is trying to free blacks. And so they began to come against the state riders, people like General Robert E. Lee, who was actually a good godly man. But he was fighting for states' rights. And then they appealed to the prejudice of some of the Southerners and said, they're going to have black people. They're going to take all y'all jobs. And black people going to be with y'all wives. And black people going to be with y'all daughters. And the KKK said, it can't be. And so they went to war, states' rights. Let's get the blacks. When none of them really was plantation owners. They wasn't that rich. It was the way it is, the same way it is today, working on the side of us. Now, we was the slave. They might have been the foreman, but we was all on the plantation. Anybody hear me up in here? All right? All right? But they skewed public opinion through propaganda, got the South going, lent the South the money to go to war, and the South went to war. And if you know Civil War history, the South was supposed to win that. But God. The South had the money, the better generals, Amen? You got to hear me now. Let me tell you, man. Can I go? The only way to anoint one was by the glory of God. They had a drunk as their star general, Ulysses S. Grant. All right? The rest of the countries had blockaded the north so where they couldn't get supplies. A Russian emperor, amen, who Russia is supposed to be our arch enemy, a Russian emperor came in, saved the north, put his ships around the north so the north can receive supplies. That emperor gave his life, y'all, so that the north could win, so the slaves could be free, and so the Rothschilds could lose that civil war. You ain't hearing me. You ain't hearing me. You go look it up. You go look it up. You go look it up. That's what the Civil War was all about. Now, the funny thing about the Rothschilds is this, and we're going to get to the word, but all we need is about 20, 30 minutes. This is important right here. All right? Because it's the word today. All right? Now, listen to me. Hey, listen to me. Now, the Rothschilds so slick, cool. They not only going to lend money to the South, but they're going to come around the table to the north and lend money to the north. You see, one way to make sure you win is to bet on, oh, God have mercy. You don't know who we dealing with. But to ensure that the South would win, they told Abraham Lincoln, you're going to have to pay us back our money. And they charged him an exorbitant interest rate. All right? I think it was like 25, 30% they wanted to charge him. You know, like loan shark rate. They was going to drain the North of money, you see, to bring it down. Economic warfare. Abraham Lincoln say, I ain't paying that. Abraham Lincoln got in his books and he said, wait, y'all lending us money and y'all controlling our money. We supposed to be printing our own money. Abraham Lincoln began to print something that he called greenbacks. Greenbacks. It was America making its own money again. All right? And they hated him. They wanted to kill him. Back to the previous quote. Look what Lincoln said. Lincoln said, I have two great enemies. Y'all know of one, but y'all didn't know the other one. The Southern Army, which is in front of me, and the bankers in the rear. You see, when you have money to control history and TV, quotes like this don't get in your books. Two great enemies, the Southern Army in front of me, the bankers in the rear, and out of the two enemies that I have, the one in the rear is the greatest one. That's the greatest enemy. That's the one I got to watch my back for. And let me tell you, after he issued them greenbacks, he was in a theater, and he didn't watch his back close enough. That booth bar came back there right behind him. He said, my greatest enemy is at my back, them bankers. And he shot Lincoln. Pow. He shot Lincoln because Lincoln was taking control of America's money from the Rothschilds by printing these greenbacks. You see? That's why Lincoln was assassinated. He played with the Rothschilds. He played with their money. Let's keep going. Y'all still awake up yet? Y'all still awake? Come on now. I know y'all. In 1869, a rabbi said this. He says, thanks to the terrible power of our international bankers, you see, and this is the Ashkenazis. This is, they are linked, all right? Thanks to the terrible power of international bankers, we have forced Christians wars without number. Wars have a special value. You see, we fight against each other, Christians on the north, Christians on the south, and they funding us. Wars have a special value for the Ashkenazi Jews. Since Christians massacre each other and make more room for us, wars are the Ashkenazi's harvest. The Ashkenazi banks grow fat on Christian wars. That's what they do. And so you got black Christians and white Christians in America hating each other, cutting up about civil war when the Ashkenazis is on the KKK side and the NAACP side. When they created the Black Lives created the white Camilla. They created both, and they're just trying to foment a war so they can make some more money. But I ain't fighting for no Lucifer, and I ain't fighting for no synagogue of Satan, and neither will my people fight for any. You see what I'm saying? Come on, come on, come on. Just give me a little more time. Don't worry about it. You see? 1913, President Woodrow Wilson. All right? Woodrow Wilson, who was their man, he put him in office. Because when you got so much money, you could put people in office that you want. All right? And a lot of times in an election, you can really want because they're gonna have that person gonna have the most money. Oh God. Yeah. I'm about to ruffle y'all feathers here in a second. Because you thinking this, you thinking that, you don't know who we fighting. And people brilliant, man. Demonically brilliant. So they got Wilson in. And Wilson for the longest was my hero, prophet. I wrote a college final paper on Woodrow Wilson. You see? But I didn't know who was actually the hand inside his puppet. And so when Andrew Jackson and the rest of them was fighting to keep the banks, the Federal Reserve out, Woodrow Wilson gave the banks the right to come in 1913. And he didn't put an expiration on the charter. He gave them an indefinite right to come in, control American money, print American money. But they didn't call it the First Bank of the United States. They didn't call it the Second Bank of the United States. They didn't call it the Third Bank of the United States. They said, we got to call it a name to where when people see it and people hear it, they're going to think it's a part of the government. But it's not a part of the government. It's a private bank. What name should we give it? Hey, God, they met in a place called Jekyll Island. This book called The Preacher of Jekyll Island tells all about the insides, all about the Rothschilds, all about what they did on that island to set up what we would call, they called it not the First Bank of the United States, they called it the Federal Reserve. And you think that's part of the government. That's not part of the government. It's not part of the government. Go back to the quote that I had. Just go back to it. In that paper, you'll see, if you look close, Wilson declares beginning of golden age of bankster fraud. They say big banks hit the jackpot with new Federal Reserve cartel scam. You see? You see that? We done forgot our history. We done forgot our history. You see? The next slide here. Come on, let's learn. Learn with me. 3 years after Wilson signed that Federal Reserve law into action, look what he says. I am a most unhappy man. I have unwittingly, he says, ruined my country. A great industrial nation is controlled by its system of credit. Our system of credit is concentrated. The growth of our nation, therefore, and all of our activities are in the hands of a what? Of a few men. We have come to be one of the worst ruled, one of the most completely controlled and dominated governments in the civilized world. No longer a government by free opinion, no longer a government by conviction, the vote of majority, but a government by the opinion of the rest of a small group of dominant men. He was saying that the government now was put into the hands of the Rothschilds and all their cronies. That's what he was saying. It's too late, my boy. You done did that. Look at the next slide. Stay with me now. This governor of New York, look what he says. The real menace of our republic is this invisible government, which like a giant octopus sprawls its slimy length over city, state, and nation. Like the octopus of real life, it operates under the cover of self-created screen. At the head of it are the Rockefeller Stand at All, which are the Rothschild's henchmen, a small group of powerful banking houses, generally referred to as international bankers. This little cadre of powerful international bankers virtually run the United States government for their own selfish purpose. They practically control how many parties? Both political parties. This was in 1922. Give me the next one. Oh, let's uncover it. That's how it looked. The banks has controlled TV, government, radio, the industries, the trains, facts. They control it all. Now, I done showed you how they control media, huh? But the banks is the key. Because if you control the money, you can control all of that. I'm about to leave. Wait. Come on, give me another slide. This is my bar right here. They assassinated McFadden. They killed him. He was a congressman. But he always told the truth. They tried to assassinate him once. I think they tried to poison him or something, and he lived. But they got him the next time. Every effort has been made by the Federal Reserve Board to conceal its power. But the truth is the Fed has usurped the government. It controls everything here in Congress, and it controls all our foreign relations. It makes and breaks governments at will. Who controls the purse controls the government. All right. Next president, President Kennedy. Listen, we're going to cover everything. We're going to cover everything. All right. President Kennedy tried to get us off the Rothschild system. He knew about it. He was a white man that God had blessed with wisdom and revelation in the running of things. He not only did a bunch of things for blacks as far as civil rights, he knew that blacks were not the enemy, but that we had another enemy from abroad that had crept in unawares, the international bankers. And so JFK says this. He says, there's a plot in this country to enslave every man, woman, and child. Before I leave this high office and noble office, I intend to what? To expose this plot. He knew about it. All right? He knew about it. All right? Let's go to the next slide. On June 4th, President Kennedy issued out Executive Order 11110. And in that executive order, Misha, he said, I am going to take back the right to print our money. You see, your money, it's a Federal Reserve on it because that's where it come from. And if all you got to do is take out your money and look, they print the money. JFK say, we're going to print our own money with that executive order. He say, forget about the Rothschilds. We're going to print our own money, make our own money, pay them off the debt we owe them, and be free from them. All right? Now, what happens to people that try to get in the Rothschild? Bam! All right? He did the executive order in June. By the time November come around, he got you, babe. You know, flip the next slide here. You see? Flip the next slide. And this is one of the quotes that in the book, and it's one of the quotes that people won't even admit that JFK say. But look at this. One day after I am long gone, you will remember me and say we should have stopped a few things. The nuclear program in Israel, that's right. It should be abolished. He says, number two, the Federal Reserve. And number three, kick all secret societies, occultists, that's the Luciferians, secret societies, because when you get to the base of all secret societies, you'll see the Rothschild hand. They go by another name. They call them the Illuminati. You'll see their hand in it. He said, we got to do away with the nuclear program. We got to do away Federal Reserve. We got to do away with these secret societies, occultists, usurpers, Zionists, out of our wonderful country, and to keep it that way. You see, you're going to remember that, he said. But remember, it is never too late just to remember that. All right? That's what JFK said. All right? And let me tell you, a few months later, he was killed. All right? That's the Federal Reserve. And that's who controls them. Let's look at them today. All right? Give me just a few more minutes. Let's look at them today. Brother Brent, can you play that clip for me of Alan Greenspan? And put it right where I want it. I believe I had it at 108.
There's an independent agency. And that means basically that there is no other agency of government which can overrule that we take.
No government agency so that can overrule the Federal Reserve.
That is in place, and there is no evidence that the administration or the Congress or anybody else is requesting that we do things other than what we think is the appropriate thing, then what the relationships are don't matter. And I've had...
What Alan was saying was this. There's no government agency, the President, the Congress, or the Supreme Court, that can override the Federal Reserve. And if they want to do something, they're going to get it done, regardless of what the President or anybody else think. In fact, they wanted to audit the Federal Reserve, see how much money they got and what they're doing with their money. Them people laugh. Audit, or back up off me, bro. Y'all don't control this. That's them today. You can't audit them. You can't control them. It's a private institution. Let's go deeper. Let me show you some pictures now. Did you know that every single Federal Reserve chairman has been Ashkenazi? Come on, come on, come on, flip it now, flip it, flip it. Look right here, look, all of them. And wait. Flip it again. Oh, that's the Rothschilds with Bill and Hillary Clinton. No, we missing a picture. Flip it again. There we go. Greenspan, Bernanke, Yellen, Cohn, Yellen, Fisher, Geithner, all of them. All the Fed chiefs have been Nazi. You ain't gonna see no black brother up there. That brother up there, he ain't running nothing. They're not even gonna put a European up there. Ashkenazi. Rothschild. All right, let's go back. Go back to the Rothschilds still live. They still live, they family. Jacob, Evelyn. They got one by the name of David. I didn't put his picture up there. When you look at him, he looked like Jesus. Not like the real Jesus. Like the fake Jesus. All right? But what people don't know is blue eyes, and you should see him, he cleaner than a whistle. What they don't know is that they waiting to bring up their Messiah. And some say it's going to be David Rothschild. You see? Yeah. Look. Don't ever say nobody ain't told you. All right? They still in operation today. I'll tell you something, blow your mind. Let's go. Look. That's Evelyn with y'all boy. All y'all was crying when she lost. She belonged to them people, dog. When they was tripping about all her emails, you ain't never heard she had an email from them, huh? They was all up in her email. She communicates with them. She they man. Oh, the world is over. She had the most money in the elections. You see? Let me flip another one. Oh yeah, that's them boys. That's the Fed chiefs. You see? All right, now let's get to this, big brother. This is going to interest you. Only a few nations withstood the central banks, the Rothschilds. They say, Chandra, we're not putting no Antichrist Rothschild bank in our country. Only a few nations did that. Let me name some of them. All right? Afghanistan, under the Taliban. Iraq, under Saddam Hussein. Iran, under the Ayatollah. North Korea. Carl, what's that boy name again? Sung Jong-il, something like that? Yeah, Sung, King Jong. Y'all know his name. All right? But look, I'm not tripping up. I respect him. I'm show you a second. Sudan, Cuba, under Castro, and Libya, under Muammar Gaddafi. Now, the people who resist the Rothschilds and say we don't want no bank, so y'all won't enslave our people, we believe that they devils and demons. Why do we believe that? Have we ever met Saddam Hussein? Did we even meet Muammar Gaddafi? Did we even meet Fidel Castro? What you believe about these people is not even your opinion. You never met these people, and these people ain't never done anything to you, but you believe that they devils and demons because somebody else told you they were. Wouldn't that be something if nothing was wrong with them people? But that these people withstood a banking cartel system because they loved their people, and they wasn't going to allow these their people to be enslaved with debt. What if Saddam really loved his people? What if Muammar Gaddafi, listen, go do your research on Muammar Gaddafi. Research his healthcare. Research how good he was doing to his people. Research that. Everything you believe about these people has been fed to you. It's been fed to you. And the very ones that you hate the most, the very ones you think the enemies of America, not really the enemies of America, they're the enemies of the Rothschilds. But whoever the enemy of the Rothschild becomes the enemy of America. And just like when we did not want to do business with the Rothschilds in 1811, they sun their arm, Great Britain, straight up the Potomac and wage, burnt down our capital in the War of 1812. The Rothschilds have another arm. It's not Great Britain. They got a stronger arm. It's America and the industrial war complex that we have in America. And when a nation don't want to do business with the Rothschilds, they don't send just Great Britain now. They send America. Can you see a correlation between the countries that didn't want to do business with them and the wars that we've been having for the past decade? Afghanistan didn't want to do business with them. Guess where America ended up? In Afghanistan. What Afghanistan got to do with America? They try to say 9-11. 9-11, them boys don't even. 9-11. What you doing fighting in Afghanistan? Oh, yeah, I know why you're fighting Afghanistan. Look, Iraq, another war. Who they want to go to war with now for their nuclear program? Iran. Remember what they told us? Saddam had nuclear weapons. Did he really have? They still ain't found no nuclear weapon. They hung that boy, man. They kill him. North Korea, oh, we hear in the news, oh, Kim Jong, yeah, he shoot missiles. Yeah, he shoot missiles. He telling y'all play with me like y'all did Muammar. I'm a new everybody up in here. All right? That's why he doing that. I'm crazy. Don't play with him. I'm crazy. Leave us alone. Why you got to have every country? Why the $500 trillion you have is not enough, Rothschild? Sudan done been split up, eaten up, war, civil war. Cuba, they just waited on Gaddafi to die. Castro to die. Libya, poor Libya. They dragged Muammar Gaddafi through the streets when he gave his people free health care, free college. If you got married, he gave you a free apartment with a stipend. He was blessing his people. He had pulled that country out of so much debt, paid money for a satellite so that they can have their own cell phone system and not be a part of the Rothschild system and stuff like that. He found water in the desert, amen. He began to irrigate. I mean, he was blessing his country. It was the country that had the least amount of debt. They was balling. And when you study Gaddafi wanted to get off the dollar and go back to the gold, man. Oh, I'm getting too deep here. And they smoke him. They smoke him. Should I tell him about Venezuela? Should I tell him about Venezuela? It's strong leaders up who love people. That's who the world hate the most. And they would hate me because I love my people. You understand what I'm saying? But Venezuela, under the leader, Chavez. Yeah, Chavez. Venezuela was balling, though. All them countries stopped doing business with Venezuela. Now they're eating dogs. You're going to let the Rothschilds in. Let me break bread with y'all some more. Who's been in the news as America's greatest enemy lately? Let me show you what Putin just did. You're only the enemy when you touch who? Let me show you what Putin just did. All right? Look, Putin bans Rothschilds from Russia. You think I'm crazy? You think I'm the only one seeing? There's other countries who done locked up some. Now, you can't keep them in jail long. But Putin done banned them. Putin said, y'all ain't coming here. Get out of here. Putin done paid off the debt. His country is back in the positive. They're not where they used to be. Hey, God, but they doing it themselves and without Luciferian help. Oh, I'm blowing y'all mind right now. Y'all want to go to war with Russia because he put Trump in office? Y'all don't know what's going on. Y'all don't know what's going on. The very one y'all wanted was a Rothschild puppet. The very one y'all want. Y'all don't know what's going on. All right? Now, I'm not saying Trump going to do any better, because the people he putting, as y'all watch, the people he putting, they Rothschild people. All right? I'm just hoping the dude is so rebellious. He got his own mind. He say anything. I'm just hoping that he got enough courage. He got enough courage. Because, look, don't get me wrong, though. He see what's going on. I'm going to say something, a secret to you. There was one time that Trump said that he would close down the Federal Reserve. I don't know if he feel that way now. Because if he do, they going to... You know what I'm saying? But watch the news. He don't trust the CIA. He don't trust the FBI. He don't trust none of them. He don't trust none of them. In fact, he done fired all the old staff and stuff like that. He got his own people cooking his food because them people are poisoning you, man. Them people are poisoning you. Trump ain't no dummy. I'm not saying I voted for him, but I'm telling you. I hope Putin got his ear.
Oh, Russia tampered with our election.
Huh? Y'all killed Muammar Gaddafi. Y'all gave Chavez cancer. Y'all been tampering with countries. Y'all been tampering with countries since y'all foundation. And this dude helped Trump in the election, and now y'all want Russia. Get out of here. Y'all tampering every election around the world. Putin bans Rothschilds from Russia. You see? And look. They want to go to war with Russia. They want to go to war with Russia. You know? Man, another slide. That'd be our greatest mistake, too. Why does Washington really hate me? Could it be because I threw out the Rothschild controlled bank from Russia? You don't know what Satan... You don't know what Russia and Putin say we should do to the Rothschilds right quick. You don't want to know what Putin say how we could solve the problems of the world. I can't say it. You ain't gonna mess around and put my family in jeopardy. I can't say it. So we did a historical study on the Federal Reserve. I showed you where they come from and what it's all about. And they letting people talk about it. It ain't no danger type stuff. They got bigger enemies than me. They letting people talk about it. Because talking about it is one thing, but actually doing something about it is another. And they like, what y'all gonna do? They like Debo, you know what I'm saying? They Debo in America. Yeah, I took it. So this is the Rothschilds. This is the Federal Reserve. This is the Ashkenazi people. And once again, I share with you that they are not the people, saints. They operating on another level, a demonic, Luciferian level, my friend. They not the people. Who the people? Come on, give God some glory. Amen. Yeah. And I think the most feared people, too. Open your Bibles and turn with me to the book of Acts. Amen. Y'all gonna get two words today. And still get out on time. We want to look at the book of Acts in chapter 5. Amen. And we want to start out about verse 17. We're going to read a little bit. We're going to break bread on our last 2 points. And then we're going to get out of here. You know. Not that y'all going to eat or nothing. You know what I'm saying? Some of y'all might be. Y'all might be doing fruits and vegetables or at one meal after six. Amen. Father, bless us as we read your word and anoint it in Jesus' name. Amen. The Bible says, then the high priest rose up, and all they that were with him, which is the sect of the Sadducees, and were filled with indignation, and laid their hands on the apostles and put them in the common prison. But the angel of the Lord by night opened the prison doors and brought them forth and said, go, stand, and speak to the people all the words of life. Father, a blessing to the reading and exposition of your word. In Jesus' name, amen. Saints, we were in the book of Acts and we saw that Ananias and Sapphira lied to the Holy Ghost, lied to God. And the power of God fell, and Ananias and Sapphira were killed on the spot. The Bible says great fear fell upon all the church. And because of that fear, purity came forth. And because of purity, power came. Because anytime you clean yourself up, God's going to send forth his power. When power came, they began to bring who was sick and lay them in the streets. And Peter would pass, and his shadow was healing people. Amen. After this power, this purity, amen, people getting saved, hallelujah, the church being added to daily. The Bible said in verse 17, amen, that the high priests, the Sadducees, that they rose up. And we began a series on persecution. Somebody say persecution. That's right, persecution. And we said anytime you're living pure, and our first point rose up, anytime you're living pure, amen, you will face persecution. Because the Bible says all that will live godly, amen, in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. And you know it. When you tell the people in your family or your friends you're not doing things and you're not rolling like that no more, amen, they talk about you, ostracize you, amen. Some people actually get fired from jobs. Some people get kicked out of schools, amen. It's all kind of stuff. If you're trying to live godly, you will be persecuted. Now, if you're a Christian and you're not trying to live for God, everything's going to be hunky-dory. Everything will be just fine. Life is good. I ain't got no enemies, no trouble. Amen. And it's a sign, amen, that the world loves you because you're acting like the world. Hey, God. If you don't act like the world will not love you. Amen. Because the world only loves its own. Anybody hear me up in here? So if you live godly, you will be persecuted. Listen, if you operating in the dunamis exousia power of God, you're going to be persecuted. If you preaching with power, if you laying on healing, if you doing anything, people getting delivered or set free, amen, and you known in hell, oh, God. What the devil done said, hey, you a mock man, mock him, amen, mock her, amen. Because anybody in their vicinity could get saved, delivered. They could start revival. They are one man, one woman revival walking around town. Amen. Anytime they open their mouth, something could happen. And the devil know that. Jesus I know, Paul I know, but who are you, they say. Are you a marked man? Are you known in hell? Are you a marked woman? Are you known in hell? Because if you're marked, amen, you will suffer persecution. You're going to suffer spiritual attacks every now and then, but you could pray your way out of that. You can you're going to suffer, hallelujah, physical attacks, amen, where the devil get his henchmen, amen, to mess up your day and do some things to burn you up or whatever. And what I'm telling you is this information is not for you being pure, not for you to stop operating in power, but just for you not to be ignorant of Satan's devices and his strategies, and for you to press on, amen, even in the face of adversity. You see what I'm saying? Yeah, persecution. You see? Persecution. We pick up in our second point right here, the high priest and the Sadducees. Say it with me, the high priest and the Sadducees. Acts 5:17, then the high priest rose up, and all they that were with him, which is the sect of the Sadducees, the denomination of the Sadducees, and were filled with indignation. So we talked about how the persecution happens. Let's talk about who persecutes, right? Let's talk about who it is who rose up and persecuted the church. They give us two names. They say the high priest and the Sadducees. The high priest represents the religious authority in the day of the apostles. You see? He was the head of Judaism. Amen. I guess if you would compare Judaism to the Catholic Church, the high priest would be like the Pope. Anybody hear me up in here? You see? So the high priest ran it all, the religious apparatus. Well, he rose up. He was a persecuting agent against the church. Not only him, the Bible says the Sadducees, all right? Well, who was the Sadducees, Pastor? Sadducees were one of the denominations of Judaism. Amen? You had different denominations of Judaism, just like we got Baptism, Presbyterian, and non-denomination. Well, Judaism, during the days of Jesus, had different denominations as well. Can anybody name me another denomination in Judaism? You had the Sadducees and the Pharisees. It's just another denomination. They believe a little bit different things, amen, but it's just another denomination. And so that's who the Sadducees were. Now, the Sadducees, amen, they believed, amen, certain nuances of the Torah, of the Old Testament. They believed, amen, that, hallelujah, let me see here. They loved the Word of God, the law, the Book of Moses. They were real conservative, meaning that, above all else, they wanted to preserve the books of Moses. Moses was their star. Was their head honcho. They kind of looked at Moses almost like Moses was God. And as we shall see, when God wanted to change things from Mosaic to Jesus, they couldn't take it. And that's why Jesus had to always tell them, listen, a greater than Moses is here. You see? He said, Moses spoke of me. Moses spoke of me. That's why the book of Hebrews say, listen. Listen now. Moses was just one of the ones in the house. Jesus was the one that built the house. You understand what I'm saying? He the foundation and the chief cornerstone. He was trying to get them right because Moses was their superstar. And the high priest actually sat in what they call Moses' seat. Because they felt that, hallelujah, he was, hallelujah, the legitimate heir. Moses' seat. And when Jesus came on the scene, Jesus said, yeah, but we're going to do something different than Moses. We're going to do a new covenant. We're going to do something different. The Sadducees couldn't take that. You see? Another problem with the Sadducees is that they knew the scriptures, but they didn't know the power of God. Meaning that they knew truth, but it didn't know how the spirit operate. Oh, y'all want to see that again, must be. They didn't know how to. They didn't. I'm hungry, forgive me. Listen, they didn't know how the Spirit operate. Because the Spirit listed where he will. You can know all the words you want, but if you don't know the ways of the Holy Ghost, you're going to be operating in the flesh and out of order. You see what I'm saying? You got to know the Spirit, baby. You see? All right? So they didn't know the Spirit. They denied God's involvement in everyday life. They felt like God set it in motion, but it was up to them to make it happen. You see, they denied God's involvement in everyday life. Number two, they denied the resurrection of the dead. So since you can't believe the Spirit, and you find that in some Christian denominations that's word heavy, they don't believe in nothing supernatural. You see? They so stoned into the letter, and the letter is dead. They can't see nothing. I've been a part of churches like that. You see? I come out of stuff like that. You see? And it's good people, Christian people. You see? But you got to worship him in spirit and in truth. You just can't worship him in truth. All right? So they denied the resurrection of the dead. You see? They denied the afterlife. When they felt, the Sadducees felt, when you died, it was over. No heaven, no hell, no afterlife. They believed in what we call in theology, annihilationalism. They denied the existence of a spiritual world. They didn't believe in angels or devils. You see what I'm saying? But the devil had his hand on them, huh? Huh? Just think of the damage he could do to them when they don't think he even exists. You see? That's the Sadducees. And then Jesus walked on the scene. And Jesus believes in everything. Everything they don't believe, he believes in it. Not only believe in it, he believed that God orders our steps. He believes that there is a resurrection. He said, I am the resurrection and the life. He believed in the afterlife. He talks about the rich man who was buried, amen, and went down to hell. And the poor man who was taken to Abraham. But he believed all that. He believed in a spiritual world of angels and devils. He said, listen, if I want to, I can get 12 legions of angels and get myself off this. I'm laying down my life because I want to lay down my life. He told Nathan, you keep on following me, and you're not just not going to see that I know what you was doing under that tree, but you shall see angels ascend and descend like Jacob's ladder. He believed in angels and devils. That's why he was casting out devils. He speak to them devils. What's your name? Legion. You see what I'm saying? The Sadducees hated him. You see? And their hate continued, not only with Jesus, but the disciples of Jesus. You see? And anything miraculous that happened to the Sadducees that they could not explain, they would say, that's not God. You know? You don't ever want to be a Sadducee. Because in life, you're going to stay sad, you see? Yeah. Yeah. God never going to move. There's never been no victories, no miracles, nothing like that. You can't see that we serve a living God. Don't be like that. Don't be like you. All we want to explain away a miracle. You know? What a doctor did, the doctor. You mean the great physician did. You understand what I'm saying? You see? One of the greatest sources of persecution against a pure and powerful church, against a pure and powerful people, against a pure and powerful Christian being successful, making a difference, one of the greatest sources of persecution will be the religious who don't really believe in the movements of God. Yeah. That's the revelation. When you find somebody stuck in religion, you see, who have a form of godliness, but their life denies the power thereof, you're going to see persecution. You see? You're going to see persecution. You see? Why, Pastor? Because they can't move with God. They don't want nobody else moving either. Mm-hmm. Hallelujah. What you mean, Pastor? Well, listen to me now. Listen to me. the Pharisee, the Sadducee, and the high priest did not have a relationship. They had religion. There is a difference between religion and relationship. All right? And anytime you got people in religion, they will always attack and persecute a people that have a relationship. Oh, I'm preaching now. I know I'm only getting a few claps. This is the reason why your family don't like you. This is the reason why your friends don't like you. This is the reason why people don't like this church. Amen. Because they in a religion and we in a relationship. And when, it's the same reason why Ishmael hated Isaac. Because Ishmael was in a religion. Isaac, the promised seed, was part of the family, and he was in relation. Go check out the book of Galatians, and you're going to get that one day. You see? Listen to me here. Relationship is good. Religion is bad. Religion is man. The Sadducees had their own rules and nuances. We call that tradition. It's not from the Bible. It's not from God. It's man's interpretation of God, which the devil can easily manipulate and get in the of. And your tradition started off right, but now your tradition is satanic and actually gone against the law of God. That's why Jesus had a problem with them boys, the high priest in them. He said, you make void the law of God by the traditions of men. When I say you should honor you done put up a tradition called Corbin that where you won't take care of your father, you won't take care of your mama, you won't honor them, amen, because of your tradition, Corbin. But you, hallelujah, do your tradition and don't do my law. I'd say I got a problem with that. When the laws of men usurp the commandments of God, you are in religion. When God say don't make no statues and you making them and bowing to them, you are in religion. When you're praying to a woman, when God say there's no mediator between hallelujah and me but Jesus Christ, you are in tradition. You're in religion. Amen. Anybody hear me up in here? Hey, God, you're in religion. You're in religion. When you're not marrying a woman, when the Bible says a preacher, a pastor can marry, and when you're not marrying, you're in tradition, a man's law, you're in religion. When you're not eating pork chops and bacon. Now, you could not do that for health reasons, but if you think that somehow you're spiritually better than somebody, because you, when the ham come over, you pass it. And now somehow you are better because you don't eat Oscar Mayer and Vienna sauce. Somehow you are better spiritually. You are a better person than me, going to get a higher seat in heaven when on the back end you refuse the ham, but you got three women on the side, but you still better than me because you man with children, you're blowing yourself up in cities, but you better than me because you don't eat ham, my friend. You are in religion. You in religion. Because you're doing things not for God's glory. You're doing it for man's approval. And I would rather be a son than a slave. I'd rather be in relationship than religion. Anybody hear me up in here? Religion can be Christless. Anybody ever was in a religion that was Christless? No Christ. Religion can be controlled by Satan. Religion can be legalistic, meaning that do's and don'ts, do's and don'ts, do's and don'ts. Where you have dominant leaders who control every aspect of the lives of their people. From what they eat, what time they go to bed, do they iron their underwear? You understand what I'm saying. Yeah, the Mormons really do that. That's religion. I don't ever want Philadelphia to become a religion. Never want us to be legalistic. You see? You see, with the set of rules, religion and powerful leaders control their people. They make their people feel like they are the ones that have the keys to open heaven or to close heaven. So their people try to please them to try to get into the afterlife, into glory. And so you're afraid to do anything against your leaders because, and you're afraid not to do because somehow they can X off your name out the Lamb's Book of Life. Let me tell you something right now. I am your pastor. And you are, by the scriptures, supposed to honor me. Supposed to even give me double honor. But don't you ever for one second think that I'm in control whether you get into heaven or whether you don't get into heaven. I don't have that type of power. That power comes from Jesus Christ alone. He is the door. He is the door. He is the Savior. Anybody hear me up in here? If you're in a place where you feel that way, that's religion. And it may even be a cult. And you better put your shoes on. And you better leave. And on your way out, don't drink the juice. Hey. Religion controls people. And because it controls people, it hates change. It hates change. And the change that it hates the most is the gospel. It hates the gospel. Religion hates the gospel. Pastor, why does religion hate the gospel? Religion binds, enslaves, makes men servants. But the gospel liberates, emancipates, sets men free, and makes them sons and daughters. Religion hates the gospel because the gospel says you don't need nobody but Jesus. The gospel says that can get you in. The gospel says you're a sinner and nobody can save you. You can't save yourself. Your friend can't redeem you. Your mama can't redeem you. Your priest can't redeem you. Your pastor can't redeem you. Money can't redeem you. Only a redeemer can redeem you. And that's Jesus Christ, the righteous one who came and bled and hung and died on Calvary's hill. Hey! Religion says you get in by obeying them. The gospel says you get in by believing him. Hey! They hate the gospel. They hate the gospel. And so they try to put laws and rules on you to control you and to control your life, to put you in a man-made system, a man-made, as though it were, web of do's and don'ts. In Christian church, be careful because we can fall into that as well. And that's why during this fast, I'm not telling you what to do on the fast. Don't you dare come to me and have me order your life. I don't want to do that. I'm not the Holy Ghost. You got the wrong pastor. You see what I'm saying? I'm trying to get you to learn how to stand fast in the liberty in which Christ had made you free. You understand that? I don't want you to listen to my rules. I want you to listen to his rules. I don't want you to just know how to hear me. I want you to learn how to hear him. Oh, you're not hearing me up in here. Oh! Listen to me. Jeremiah tells us in the 33rd chapter. He tells us a new covenant will I make with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. I love how he singles us out. He says, listen, it's not going to be like the old covenant, the commandments which you break when you was in the wilderness with Moses. Because immediately when I gave you my laws, you broke them. You couldn't do legalism. It didn't work. He said, but I'm going to make a new covenant with you. He says, I'm going to write my laws on your heart. And I'm going to write them in your spirit, you see. And he says, listen. He says, in that same chapter, he said, no man going to really have to teach you about God. And people don't understand that. What does that mean, Pastor? I stopped coming to church? No, he's not saying that. He's saying, but there's going to be another teacher living on the inside of you. The paraclete, the Holy Ghost, the comforter, the one that will lead you into all truth and guide you into all the light. Listen, this paraclete would be your teacher, and Pastor ain't got to be there. You're going to know whether what you're about to do is right or wrong. Something we call conviction. Something we call confirmation. Something we call affirmation. Something we call negation. The spirit in you, hey, going to tell you whether the way you're going is right. Now, a lot of times you're going to be able to come to church. And when I preach something, it's not that you never felt it. No, you heard it already. You felt it already. And when you come to church, my job is to confirm what the Holy Ghost is already doing in you. My job is just to confirm that. Anybody hear me? That's why and you come to me and you say, you know, we was just talking about that, me and Trish over here the other day. Why? Because the Holy Ghost was talking. When two or more gather together, there I am in the midst. Anybody ever had that happen before where the Holy Ghost done taught you something? Hallelujah, Brother Jack, Miss Annette. Hey, my job is to confirm that and to make sure you're on the right path. Whether you really heard the Holy Ghost or whether that was indigestion. Because sometimes you should have got you some Pepto-Bismol or some Tums. All right, and you say, oh, the Spirit said. That wasn't the Spirit. And so you need to come to church to get a confirmation. To get a confirmation, amen, from your spiritual elders. All right? But the new covenant was not thou do, thou that. The new covenant was relationship. And I'm going to lead you. You see? I'm going to lead you. I'm going to tell you. You know? I'm never going to tell you something outside of Scripture now. I'm never going to have you doing things that is not consistent with my character and my word. You know? But I want you to be in a relationship with me. You see? Come on, give God some glory. We almost done. Religion hates change and it hates the gospel because relationship with God and the gospel sets men free from one another. You got to understand that there's some people that get over the people of God and they've been waiting for authority. They've been waiting for somebody to listen to them and look at them. And so they began to lord over the people of God. They began to fulfill all their desires about having somebody under them. That's not consistent with the New Testament. It's not consistent with the New Covenant. When you're a leader in the New Covenant dispensation, you understand that you are not a lord. Mm-mm. You are under shepherd. You are manager. And you are a son. But the rest of them are sons and daughters too. You just an older brother. And there's a difference between what an older sibling can do to the children and what a parent can do to the children. We got some of y'all even in y'all 12s and stuff like that, and in the ministries you in, you acting like you not a son or a daughter too. You done got the big head, you. You rule, and then you call me mom, call me daddy. And I understand to a certain extent you might have some spiritual parentage under me and my wife who are under the Most High God. But 12 leaders, don't ever start smelling yourself now. Because we're going to remove you in the blink of an eye. It ain't nothing for me. I sign a paper. You ain't got no 12 group. Remember what you have has been given to you. And in a minute, I'll take it away. I'll take it away in a minute. I'll take it away in a minute. I'm hungry. I'll take, look, just give me that. Smell yourself. Your older brother, your older sister, operate with your siblings accordingly. Amen? Operate with them accordingly. Because even me, you know what I'm saying? I don't lord it over Philly. We ain't gonna get to point number three. I don't lord it over Philly, so don't lord it over your ministries. Because if you do, you're acting like those in religion. And when we go to change something, you're the first one mad. Why are they changing that? Can't with the spirit. Like Biz will say, simmer down, settle down. Get your hands off the crown. You see? They don't do it like the king do it. Look, we're almost done. In 1517, Martin Luther rose up against the Roman church. When I say the Roman church, I mean the Roman Catholic church, because he was a priest. In 1517, he saw that the Catholic church was salvation. They were selling indulgences, and they was doing religion and not relationship. He wrote 95 theses. And he tacked those theses, arguments, contentions against the church door. And his original 95 theses was not to separate the church, but to bring the church to repentance and renewal, and to bring the church back to relationship. And even to this day, we have nothing against the Catholic Church. We have nothing against any of the other religions, but our contention is come out of religion and get back to relationship. And when he had that 95 thesis on the door of that Wittenberg church, he attached that and he began to lay siege against their false doctrines, their biblical illiteracy, the people didn't know the Bible. When he lay siege against their superstition, believing in all kind of Easter bunnies and lucky rabbit's feet and everything else. Y'all know how he was. And the unbiblical doctrines of purgatory and selling indulgences and salvation through good works. And so he laid siege to religion, trying to pull them back to relationship. But religion withstood Martin Luther. And withstood him so much, they had assassins waiting. Persecution will oftentimes come from the most religious amongst us. The most do, not, and don't. Who in their secret lives got it all messed up. If they did it to Jesus, if they did it to the disciples, if they did it to Martin Luther, as you operate in your relationship, recognize that the religious will do it to you, my friends. Those that don't have a true relationship with Yahshua Jesus, amen, will persecute the ones that do. It comes from the religion. Listen to me good. You got to watch it. You got to watch it, amen, that you do not be religious. And you got to watch it, amen, that, hallelujah, when the religious persecute you, hallelujah, it won't take you by surprise. It can happen even in this church. On the fast, people get mad when you eat a peppermint. Drink milk, chew some gum. You look at them in your face and you say, this is my fast and not yours. I am fasting unto the Lord. Get out of here. All right? Get out of here. You know? Got a bunch of people in here that's going to try to be your pastor and try to be your first lady and try to reign and lord over you, even in ways that me and first lady would never do. You know, that's the religious. I have in my notes, my dude, you could do what you want. You can have your own relationship with the Lord. Follow the Holy Spirit as he leads you to follow the word. Come on, give God some glory. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's bow our heads and pray. God, we thank you so much for blessing us with a word, Lord. You've blessed us, Lord, as we delved into the current mysteries of our day. But you've also blessed us, God, by talking about, amen, the religious and their persecution of those with relationship. Help us to never be like that. And Lord, we just want to pray for those who may be here who are still stuck in religion and who are relying upon others to save them and not you. I pray, O King, that you would bless them with a real salvation, O King. I pray, God, that you would bless them to admit their sinners, believe in Jesus, and that they would confess that you are Lord. Listen, with every head bowed and every eye closed, you ain't got to worry about what's going on. We got you with that. Just close your eyes and bow your head. If you are here this morning and you would say, Pastor, I am unsure of my salvation. I don't know if I really know him. Listen, nobody is looking but God and but me in this place. Just slip up your hand right quick. If you want to make sure that you know him, look, I see you in this section, God. You want to make sure you know him. I see another hand. Thank you, Lord. I see hands all over the room spread out. You want to make sure that you know him, that you're not in religion, but that you're in relationship. Just go ahead and put your hand up. I see you. Okay, put your hands down. If you're a Christian and you're here, and you feel like you have slipped into a bunch of do's and don'ts, well, you either lording over people or you done slipped back into religion yourself, you've took your eye off of Jesus. If that's you, Christian, just up your hand. Let me see you. Only God and me. I see some hands. You done slipped into that. And you've slipped into a place where you think your obedience to God is what's going to get you into heaven. If you believe in that, then you done slipped into religion. Because what we do don't get us saved. It's who we believe that gets us saved. You can put your hands down. I'm going to pray with you right now. And you're going to get saved in your seat. If God can save in other contexts, he can save you in church. Well, the kind, not the projects, but y'all know what I'm talking about. Pray with me right now. Say, Lord, thank you for loving me. Thank you, Lord, to the cross. Thank you, Lord, for being buried in a grave. And thank you for rising. I believe it with my whole heart. Now, Lord, I admit that I'm a sinner. And I pray right now that you would save me. Not because of me, but in spite of me. Lord, save me, a sinner. You said, if I believed you, that you would forgive me. Your child, well, I believe in the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. Lord, save me, a sinner, in Jesus' name. Amen. Come on, give God some glory, saints. Come on, give him some glory. Come on, give him some glory, saints. Hallelujah. May the Lord bless you. May he keep you. May he cause his face to shine upon you. May the Lord be gracious to you. May he lift up his countenance upon you and bless you with peace, with shalom, with healing in your body, healing in your mind, on your family, and favor, hallelujah, with your children. We pray right now that you be blessed coming in and blessed going out. You be the head and not the tail, above and not beneath. Yeah, they own the system, but our God owns the cattle on 1,000 hills. And we will be blessed. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen, amen. Love y'all. Be blessed.